Sunday morning on the Costa del Sol, and among the holidaymakers, three Irish terrorists were planning a bloodbath. A white car headed down the coast road, driven by an IRA bomber. The destination was Gibraltar, still Britain's vital military outpost at the entrance to the Mediterranean.
Royal salute! We stay on!
The IRA have admitted that their plan involved explosives, and all evidence suggests that the target was a ceremony that is a symbol of British tradition on the rock and a major tourist attraction. Every Tuesday morning, in normal times, soldiers and a military band parade in front of the Governor General's residence. The ceremony ends round the corner in a side street 100 yards away. And it was here, at this moment, that the IRA apparently planned to set off a massive car bomb. Instead, three bombers were shot down after carrying out the first stage of their plan, driving in an empty car to secure a parking space as close as possible to their intended victims. In the same street where 140 pounds of high explosive would have detonated, I spoke to a former explosives expert with the British Army. Lieutenant Colonel George Stiles was for 3 years commander of bomb disposal in Ulster. He says the bomb would have annihilated soldiers and spectators alike.
Well, we're talking about it in seconds, but in milliseconds, the car would disintegrate. The shrapnel could go nowhere. It would ricochet off the walls of the building opposite and the wall behind. But above all that, you've got a tremendous concentration of blasts because of the building so close together and the smallness of the area and so forth. And in the middle of all that, you've got people.
And what would have been the effect on these people, the band, principally, of the Royal Anglian Regiment?
Well, they wouldn't survive. People are fragmentable. They can be torn apart, and they are torn apart by the effects of concentrated blast. And I think anybody in this area would not survive.
Enniskillen, on November 8th last year, showed what a far smaller bomb can do to a mass of people. In this case, civilians gathered together for Remembrance Sunday. The 40-pound bomb had been placed inside a building next to the route of the Remembrance Day parade. In the wave of blast and flying rubble, 11 people died and more than 50 were wounded. Some wounds heal. Others last long after the memory of the atrocity has begun to fade. Until the bomb, Ronnie Hill was the much-loved headmaster of the local high school. Today, his wife Noreen keeps watch as he lives on in a deep coma that may sadly prove irreversible. The coma began during emergency surgery to save Mr. Hill's life after the blast had badly damaged his lungs.
His mind hasn't started to work yet. I mean, he can hear us. He can hear what we're saying. But he can see difference in day and night. He can feel, but he can't move at all. On his own, he can't move.
And you're obviously sustained by the hope that he will get better.
Oh, yes. We have faith that he will get better. The Lord will start his brain working in his time. And we've got to wait until that time.
After Enniskillen, the Provisional's political leadership expressed regret. But in fact, the IRA was already planning the Gibraltar outrage. And one of the Gibraltar terrorists talked about Enniskillen in a recorded conversation in a suburban house in Belfast.
It's all a political act. That even what happened in Enniskillen was a political act. Because it wouldn't have happened if Britain weren't in Ireland.
The speaker was Mairéad Farrell, who claimed on tape that she was against civilian casualties because they didn't help the struggle. She had recently been released after serving more than 10 years in prison for planting bombs in a Belfast hotel, an act she committed at the age of 19. In the same tape, she said she was lucky the police didn't shoot her when they found her outside the hotel.
I don't know, nowadays I don't take prisoners. Mm. You know, I was lucky. I was lucky.
In prison, Farrell led the women's dirty protest, smearing excrement on the walls of their cells. After her release, she re-entered the IRA's military structure in a special unit attached to the General Headquarters staff. In the same team were Sean Savage, a committed terrorist known for his bomb-making skills, and Danny McCann, known to British intelligence as one of the IRA's most dangerous killers, who chose to shoot his victims at point-blank range. Last year, McCann was photographed with a cross that he claimed British soldiers had delivered to his door in Belfast. These were the three terrorists who came back dead from Gibraltar. It's now clear that their unit's mission was to strike a major blow to revive IRA morale. Instead, they were tracked and died in what seemed a stunning military success for British forces. But in the way of Northern Ireland, that success is already turning sour, soured by the violence of the following days and by the questions that still surround the deaths in Gibraltar. Where the terrorists, as some have charged, executed.
They put their hands up when they saw these men with the guns in their hands, but they couldn't say anything. There was no interchange of words. There was just shots. Once they dropped down, one of the men, this man who still had the gun in his hand, carried on shooting. He bent down and carried on shooting at their heads.
Well, it seems to me that if you can get that close to someone, if you can get within 4 feet of your target, is it really necessary to shoot them, or even if it is necessary to shoot them, is it necessary to shoot them to kill them?
It was on November the 5th last year, 4 months before the shooting, that the IRA operation in southern Spain got underway, arriving at Malaga Airport, a member of their special headquarters unit. The terrorist who mingled with the other passengers was Daniel McCann, the gunman from Belfast, carrying a false Irish passport in the name of Riley. As he went through passport control, he appeared to slip through routinely. But in reality, Spanish security police were already watching for him. It turned out that McCann's destination was Torremolinos. In fact, the first tip-off that helped to locate the Irish terrorists here on the Costa del Sol came from London. I'm told that the Spanish police had received a message from the British authorities warning them that an IRA group could be trying to operate on Spanish soil. The message included a list of names together with descriptions and possible aliases. At the Ministry of the Interior in Madrid, the decision was taken to help the British as part of an agreed European strategy against terrorism.
Between the EU countries, we share the same approach to democracy, to freedom, and to terrorism. So although there is no strict obligation, it is quite clear and understanding what is the terrorism, how to fight against.
So in a case like Gibraltar, for example, there would have been no question, there was no question about whether you were going to help or not. You really were committed to doing it.
The answer was given by the facts.
There was no question but that you were going to go ahead and do what the British asked.
We did.
The Spanish Security Service agreed to track the terrorists wherever they went and keep the British fully informed of their movements. They searched as the IRA unit moved from hotel to hotel, using false passports in various different names. Details of thousands of tourists were sifted by police computers, which checked hotel registration cards against lists of known false documents and names. By mid-November, they had pinpointed three terrorists. Daniel McCann, Sean Savage, and another woman terrorist whom police in both Britain and Spain still refused to name. The fourth member of the IRA unit, she travelled under the false name of Mary Parkin. According to the Spanish security police, their men, disguised as tourists, managed to eavesdrop on the IRA team and overheard them discussing a bomb attack, though the target was not yet clear.